God is making the final preparations for the long-awaited advent of our bringer of hope, our savior of love, our joy, our prince of peace. We wait, we prepare, we make straight the way. Today we light the candle of peace. O God, make us ready for the coming of the Prince of Peace. This is the fourth Sunday of Advent, and today we will continue to sing, O come, Emmanuel. We'll sing the fourth verse.
Welcome to St. Paul's United Methodist Church's online and digital service this morning, this wonderful December morning. I do have a couple of announcements that we need to go over before we get started. Today is a Mission Sunday. If you want to make a separate offering and give to the United Methodist Student Day, that's what this is. And it's the last of the special United Methodist offerings that happened during the calendar year. So if you wish to make a special offering for United Methodist students, I invite you to write a check and send it to us at St. Paul's United Methodist Church, P.O. Box 921, Lufkin, Texas, 75902. I also want to invite each and every one of us and every one of you that is participating this morning or participating whenever you're participating to join us on Christmas Eve. Our Christmas Eve service will premiere on December 24th, Christmas Eve, at 6 p.m. on both Facebook Live and YouTube Live. And our Christmas Eve service this year is going to be a combined service, a joint service between with us in First United Methodist Church in Lufkin. There'll be some amazing music. That we'll have some other things that are really, really great for worship. And if you want to invite friends, invite family, whether they're next door or all over the world, to go to Christmas Eve service with you, you can do it. But you'll do it in each one of your houses. And I think that this is something that may be one of these special things that happen from now on, that we have this opportunity to worship together wherever we are, whether we're in Angelina County, whether we're in Texas, or wherever we are in the world, we can still come together as a family and a family in God. And this is going to be something that is really, really amazing. We still have our toiletries and clothing drive for Angelina Crisis Center collection boxes are both here on Sunday mornings for our 9 o'clock worship and also in the narthex of the sanctuary on Thursdays from 11 to 2. Are we going to open up this Thursday?
Oh, no, that's Christmas Eve.
Yeah. Most Thursdays, but not this Thursday. Okay. And I have one more announcement, and this is a point of kind of pastoral privilege. I want to welcome people that are watching this service all over, especially Evelina Patterson, who is worshiping with us in Florida. She sent us a Christmas card. She sent us an offering, telling us how much that she enjoys so that she can be with St. Paul's United Methodist Church. If you are worshiping with us online, if you are on Facebook or YouTube, if you put in something on the comments to let us know that you're there, if you're worshiping somewhere else and you just want to drop us a card, you can drop us a card at P.O. Box 921, Lufkin, Texas, 75902. And we would love to hear from you. At this point, let's go ahead and open up with a prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this opportunity that we have to worship you today. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit on this church, or your Holy Spirit on this service, so that this can be truly a wonderful and meaningful worship experience. We ask these things in your Son, Jesus' name. Go fight, win. Amen.
Our profession of faith will be the Apostles' Creed, number 881 in your hymnal. Please rise. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
During our worship service that we lift up the joys and concerns of the community up for prayer. Do we have any other joys? This is the last week of Advent. Christmas is this week. And that is a very joyous thing. And this Christmas, I think it's been really, really special this year. I know that there's a lot of things that are really wild and wacky and they're out of place. But for some reason or another, that's making this Christmas, I've kind of enjoyed it. You know, I do miss a lot of traditions that I've had through the years, but at the same time, there's a lot of things that are happening different this year, and it is special. It's one that I will remember. Do we have any other joys that we need to lift up? As far as concerns that we need to lift up this morning, please keep Susan Smith in your prayers as she is mourning the loss of her Aunt Ethel. And also lift up all the, we want to lift up all the healthcare workers and frontline workers. And as the vaccine is rolling out, my wife doesn't know if she's going to be able to take the vaccine this week. She'll literally know Wednesday when they start giving out vaccines if she's high enough on the list or not. But with other vaccines coming out, she feels pretty strong, pretty safe that she will be on that list at least in the next couple of weeks, and that is a joy. And so keep everybody lifted up, because we are having more and more of the COVID outbreak right now. We're seeing higher and higher numbers every day. And so we are asking that people stay safe. That is the reason that we're doing a December 24th online only Christmas Eve worship. And there's some other things that we really, really do, because, you know, hope is on its way. We can see things coming, but they're not here yet. And so continue to do the things that you do to make it safe so that you won't be one of those that catch COVID at the last moment. Do we have any other concerns that we need to lift up? Well, let's go to our Lord in silent prayer and reflection. Dear Lord, we come to you this morning, a very excited church, a very excited congregation, a very excited people. We are excited because this is the week of Christmas. This is the week that we celebrate the birth of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us get through this week. Give us the strength that's needed so that we can do the things, because this is a week like no other week in the year. This is a week that has lots of challenges. This is a week that where people get busy. This is a week where we just get so excited that sometimes it's very difficult to slow down and stop. We ask that you give us that time that we can slow down and really remember that we are celebrating the birth of a child over 2,000 years ago in a faraway land that has forever changed this entire world and our lives. Lord, we lift up those that are worshiping here this morning, that are worshiping online, whether it be this morning or whenever they can fit it in their busy schedule. We ask to bless each and every one of those and listen and hear the prayers that are coming up. We ask that you continue to bless Susan as she gets through the grief of the loss of her Aunt Ethel. And we lift up all the others that are grieving and mourning in this time. And we know that this can be a very difficult time, because with all the excitement and all the celebration, when we mix in the grief of a past loved one, it gets very, very real, and it gets very, very difficult to live and work in this world, because everybody else is just so, so radically happy. We lift up our medical workers. We lift up all the people. We lift up the excitement that we have because of new vaccines that are here, that are coming, and we can see a light at the end of the tunnel. We have this hope that we can go back to a world to where we are no longer physically distant from everyone, where we can come together and we can hug and we can sing. But we ask that as we go through these last few weeks and months, that you give us the strength so that we can do the things that are necessary, not just to keep us safe, but to keep our families and our friends safe as well. Lord, we ask that you bless this congregation, bless all the things that we do, bless all of the things that we do just inside and also outside, as we are the hands and feet of Christ as we go out into the world. We ask that you continue to smile upon us so that we can feel your love, that we can feel your mercy, just as we have done in years past. Lord, we lift up this and so many other prayers as we pray together that prayer that Jesus taught us when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters. Did you know that your baby boy has come to make us new? This child that you delivered would soon deliver you. Oh, Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? That when you kissed your little baby, you've kissed the face of God? Oh, Mary, did you know? Your baby boy was Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? That the sleeping babe you're holding is the great I Am.
They're best friends and they're blue. They're always here for you. Everyone loves Chip.
Hey, Tater.
Hey, Chip.
Are you ready for Christmas?
Ready or not, here it comes.
So, is that a yes or a no?
What?
Never mind.
You know, Chip, I've been thinking.
Not again. I thought we discussed this.
What?
So, what you thinking about or with?
This whole Christmas stuff.
What about it?
I've been thinking a lot about Mary lately.
You have?
I have. And you know what I have decided?
Kinda scared to ask, but what?
I don't know why we are so obsessed with Mary right now.
Well, she is the mother of Jesus.
So?
She did show an awful lot of confidence in what an angel had told her.
I guess. But shouldn't we focus more on Jesus? Focus more on the Son and not the mother?
I'm not sure I know where you're going with this. Personally, I think Mary is a very important part of the whole Nativity story.
But not as big as Jesus, right?
Well, maybe not, but...
Then why is everyone so obsessed with Mary?
Well, why do you think people are obsessed?
Because everywhere I go, it's Merry Christmas! And have a Merry Christmas! Honestly, doesn't anyone say, have a Jesus Christmas? No, it's all about Mary.
So, to be clear, you think that everyone is saying Merry Christmas?
Think nothing.
Truer words were never said.
So why is everyone so gung-ho about Mary?
Tater, listen carefully. They are not saying Merry Christmas with an A. They are saying Merry Christmas, spelled M-E-R-R-Y. It means happy.
Oh. Then Merry Christmas, Chip!
But actually...
Oh, no! Here it comes, the intellectual explanation!
Do you mind?
Not usually.
Mary is a big part of the Nativity story. She was very young and told that her life would be turned upside down, but she accepted all that the angel said with dignity and with grace. She is an example to all of us. Mary shows love. Love to her people, love to her unborn son, and love to God.
Well, maybe we should say Merry Christmas.
Maybe. So let's be joyful and merry. I think that's what Mary would want. Why don't we pray? Everyone, bow your heads and repeat after me. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Help us remember that this.
Help us remember that this.
Is when we celebrate your birth.
Is when we celebrate your birth.
Thank you for the gifts you give us.
Thank you for the gifts you give us.
And thank you for the gift of your mother Mary.
And thank you for the gift of your mother Mary.
Amen.
Amen. I think there's only one more thing left to say.
I agree, Tater.
Merry Christmas! And have a happy newt year!
Did you just say happy newt year? Never mind.
Our scripture this morning comes from the book of Luke, the first chapter, verses 26 through 38. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, open up our hearts, open up our minds, and help us learn. We ask these things in your Son Jesus' name. Go fight, win. Amen. I just want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas. And that's right, this is Mary Sunday. We're talking about Mary, the mother of Jesus today. You know, I must confess that the character of Mary is a difficult one for me as well, not just for Tater. And there's a couple of reasons. First of all, you know, some Christians make Mary almost a deity. Almost a god, and she wasn't. But the second is almost the polar opposite. because we have a God on one side, but we often do not grasp how difficult God made poor Mary's life. How unfairly she was treated, and we will look at both of those as we look this morning. First of all, let's look at Mary the God. Maybe it's my Protestant bias that's really coming through here, because most of the people that really elevate Mary to the deity stage, either on person or on screen, are, you know, we think that they're all Catholic, right? That, you know, Mother Mary, blah, blah, blah. And sometimes this is a stereotype, and we just feed into this stereotype. But at other times we can look at it is real. We don't see a lot of Protestants praying to Mary. We don't see a lot of Protestants doing Hail Marys. The only ones that we might see typically will have had a very, very strong Catholic background. This causes me some anxiety to even mention this stereotype, because I don't want to throw my Catholic brothers and sisters under the bus. I'm not hating on them at all. Actually, my beliefs and most Roman Catholics are probably like 98, 99% the same. I mean, we're really close. Have you ever really thought about that? That how close our beliefs are to other Christian denominations are just almost identical, but we just have these little bitty small sticking points that seem that everybody just gets all stressed out about. I also realized that my strong Methodist beliefs, because I've been raised Methodist, are really based in the Catholic tradition. So even those few differences, those minor differences, are not salvation issues at all. They're just little things. But, you know, let's go back, because, you know, I couldn't be a preacher in a Catholic church. You know, I've been disqualified. I've been married twice. You know, that's kind of a disqualifier. And that's okay. I'm okay with that. I'm fine with that. But I'll be honest that praying to Mary used to, and it still does kind of bother me. I don't know why, it just does. And I know that these issues that divide us are usually propped up by ignorance. So I went and tried to get a good explanation. And so I worked with a lady that was real strong in her Catholic belief. And she was constantly, she'd break down to, Mother Mary, blah, 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 blah. And so I finally asked her, why do you pray to Mary? And why don't you pray to Jesus? Why don't you pray to the Lord? And her answer was not particularly helpful. She says, it's just like praying to any other saint. Okay, well, why do you pray to any other saint instead of Jesus? Because I don't pray to saints, I pray to gods. And you know, God doesn't use saints to categorize, he doesn't, because God's powerful enough to take care of things directly. So then I decided I'd talk to a priest, and most of them ducked or dodged the question. But I finally had one that actually, because you know they get asked this all the time. What do you pray to Mary? And so he says that the reason that we don't pray to Mary, it's intercessory prayer. We're using Mary, we're using other saints the same way that you would ask anybody else to pray with you. Because we believe that Mary, we believe that the other saints are still with us. And so we can ask them to pray with us, just as you would pray, ask a Bible study to pray for you, to ask your church to pray for you, to ask your friends to pray for you. It's just intercessory, that we're not praying to them, we're asking for Mary's help, because she is with us. That was really good justification. And in a lot of reasons, and a lot of times, I think that would be truth. But I also see that sometimes everybody does not understand that particular way that works. And so there is this divide, because we, especially in the Protestant ways, can think that Mary is being treated as a god. And we know that God gets kind of sticky about, praying to other gods beside himself. But that being said, And I won't dwell on that anymore because it doesn't need to be dwelled. This is Mary Sunday. This is the day that we do celebrate Mary, the mother, because she should be celebrated. Just as we celebrate the saints that have gone with us, just as we celebrate other things that happen through the year, we should celebrate her because Mary personifies love and grace. She did have a very important task, a huge task, because she had to bear and raise up Jesus, who is God. Have you ever thought about that? You had to raise the Son of God. I had to raise Ben and Grider. That was tough enough. You know, if they were the sons of God instead of the sons of Steve, woo, that would be a very, you know, that'd be a lot on my shoulders. And that brings me to the second issue. And that is, and I do have an issue with this. Why did a loving and caring God pick on this little girl like they did? Because let's look at today's reading, if you will. Because Gabriel, the angel, God's messenger, goes to Nazareth in Galilee with a mission. Now, Nazareth was this podunk little town out in the sticks. It was not important to anyone. That is, you know, it was country come to country. It was the river crest of Judea, you know. But Gabriel goes to this young, possibly very young. You know, there's a lot of scholars that think she was very young. And, you know, greetings. Ooh, that's a bad way to start anyway. You got to run when an angel comes and says greetings. But greetings, you are very lucky. You know, is this the publisher's clearinghouse knock on the door? No, not quite. But you are very, and let's talk about Gabriel, because this is an angel that God used to deliver very important messages from God. He gave these messages to Daniel, the great prophet, to Zechariah, the great prophet, now to Mary. He was God's premier delivery guy. He was UPS on steroids. He was the man. He was the angel. So Gabriel told her, that's a very important that we talk about that, because he told her, he did not ask, that she will be giving birth to a son and that she will name him Jesus. Now, that's the other part. You know, first of all, you're going to have a baby. And you are going to name him this. He's going to tell an expectant mother what to name her child. He's a brave angel. He is. You know, and that this boy will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His reign will have no end. So she asked, of course, the biological question of how, and you know, that there are challenges with this, and that's when the Holy Spirit is brought in. And so let's look at this. A young girl, a young single girl, possibly about the age of 13, who's engaged but unmarried, is about to have a child. You know, this is going to create some immediate serious issues. First of all, would her betrothed understand and stay with her? Probably not. Not without God's intervention, and God did intervene. Would the other townspeople understand? You know, she was at the top of the gossip list for literally all her life because of what was about to happen. There's other questions. She's a young girl in a time where childbirth was a very critical situation. Would she survive childbirth? This is not a given. You know, many, many people died at childbirth at this time. You know, would she be able to do this and survive? She would also have to flee to a foreign land with the police looking for her at the same time. And then we also know that even though she was the mother of the King of Kings, she would never live in a palace. She would never have the earthly trappings of royalty. And of course, we also know that she would have to witness the brutal way that her firstborn was put to death. Those are some real serious stuff to throw at a young girl, as a young lady. Despite all of this, what was her answer? I am the Lord's servant. Let it be. Yes, that's where Sir Paul got the. That's where he got the inspiration for the Beatles' most popular song. Just let it be. It's all about faith, the faith of a plain young woman in a very plain backwards town. When told what God was doing, she said, come on, let it be, let's go. Maybe I should give Mary more attention. Maybe I should give her more praise, not just on Mary Sunday, which happens every third year, because, you know, here we are in Christmas time, and not just in Advent. Let's spread it out a bit. This is a time of celebration in this time of Advent, a time of fellowship, and a time of happiness. It's also a time of preparation, getting ready for the coming of the Messiah. So I have to ask you this question. What would you do if Gabriel came to you and said, greetings, you are in God's favor, and you will do some very difficult things to prepare for Jesus? Would you negotiate for better terms? I think that's what I'd probably do. I go, well, if I'm going to do this, why don't we do this? Or would you just flat out agree? Would you just come out and say, if it's God's will, let it be? When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in our hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. There will be an answer, let it be. Go fight, win. Amen. Our closing hymn today is There's a Song in the Air. We'll be singing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Thank you.
go out into the world, showing the world God's love and God's grace, not just by the things that you say, but by the things that you do. Go fight, win. Amen.
Merry Christmas! Hava, Vakila, Hava, Vakila, Hava.